actually have to sit involvement in that one. We were all big involvement in the local plans and the big issues, of course, but the day-to-day stuff that probably under what did I do, or what did you do, or what did anyone else do. An issue was raised about not so much reinventing the wheel, but an issue about constitutions and models. As members know, I've sent out some paperwork to the spokespersons about Brighton and Sutton. I'm happily read through paperwork. I've caught up with links there for other members who haven't sent the paperwork to. I'll certainly send the paperwork to so we all start and know what's happened elsewhere. And again, that means we're not reinventing the wheel. We are looking at best practice in other places to try and fulfil our responsibilities.
Well, I'll take Jill and then I'll move on maybe up to Jill and Chris, and then I'll move on. Basically, I know we're going to be on this all year, and I'm going to lay a bit of time and complete it tonight. So, Jill.
It's only a very small point. It's just that every system, whichever way we go, whether we stick to what we've got, or whether we move forward with something slightly different, or however that's formed, is that they both have pros and cons, which we're all aware of. But I'm still very mindful that we must bring in what the public value is of everything that we do, whether that's on a financial matter, whether it's on a decision-making matter, and do we really want to go forward, and do the residents of Wirral understand the difference between that strong leadership model, or do they want to see some sort of consensual politics put in place, and that would like whatever reports we put forward to conclude that and always be mindful of the residents and what is being decided upon or being put forward in order for that to be best practice.
I think that's a fair point, and then, you know, ultimately it goes to council, and everyone can stand up and be counselled on what they wish to see. Chris?
Yeah, just in response to Councillor Wood's comments there, I don't disagree, but if you look at 2.71, small three brackets, it says, after passing a resolution, to publish in one or more newspapers circulating the area a notice which describes the features of the new system and timescales by which the change will take effect. So that would be notifying the public. But it also says there is no requirement of forming insults upon any proposals. Perhaps when away from Group 6, it might want to put in there that it would want to consult for those proposals. Just as a way forward, perhaps some of the good working group.
I can see all that that's put down in the in those points. It was just that when we go through to workshop stage, when we actually go through sort of tracking stuff up, is that we actually are mindful of doing that and just putting it in place. It's just all that that's there. It's not in the full body.
Okay, I think that's something that can go in there that I think can say consider. Okay, so on with regard to this then, I'll just go back to the agenda. Right, so the proposal is obviously that we have a workshop, I think Phil's just said the date of the 11th of July. Now that was at 10 a.m. Now the only thing, hopefully as many of us can be there as possible, the only thing that we wanted to discuss as well or think about, are we just going to keep it within this committee for the people who are invited, or do you want to open it up to all members? Now it could become massively unwieldy. If we actually open this to all members, personally, I think it should just be this committee. You've got representatives from every group on it to actually have a say. I think it could get a little bit nuts if we actually invite everyone. Moira?
I completely agree with you, Chair. I think it's for us to get the working party going, we'll come up with a set of proposals and present them to the wider group of councillors. Otherwise, we will be all over the place and we'll agree nothing. There
are
66 different ideas about what we need.
I don't
guess
66,
it
takes on that body. Yeah, I think not by half that. My only concern is that I can't even data hire as a matter of putting forward a deficit, if that's actually
happening. I think, are we talking a workshop for designated members, or are we talking a whole committee? Normally a workshop has one or two members from each group or whatever. I mean, it doesn't normally involve the whole committee. That allows the deputies to sit in. So if Janette couldn't make one and she was a nominated person to sit on the workshop, then either Paul or Jill could step in for them. The same with the interior, if you were looks like it worked, then I'd insist it be here.
Completely opposite suggestion on that one, to be honest.
I would suggest that we, so sorry about that, I would suggest that we do something along the lines of this Blakeley's setting. It's what we've always done in the past, to be honest. It's a workable number. It can be flexible. If somebody can't make it, you can get somebody else in who understands at what point the discussion stopped, because we don't want to have to go back to the start every time. But it's unwieldy to make it too
big. Okay, we'll go with that then. So a lot of representatives from each group, it's probably most likely going to be the spokes. If that individual can't make it, someone else can. And then we'll set out what we actually want from it going forward from there, and then there'll be future meetings within that working group. So, okay.
Yeah.
Go on.
So I'm going to make another suggestion that we actually use the model of task and finish, where we start off with our objectives and then we come to conclusions, and our conclusions would be what the recommendations are going to be, so that we actually structure it properly.
Yeah, no, that's an idea, suggestion. I think it's asking for you to structure to it. Okay.
There's a set format for doing that, I think it probably works.
It was only for confirmation, Chair, so that's a working group of the group spokes who were there yesterday, one nominees, and then a workshop of those same number of nominees.
Agreed.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, that's agreed. We will move on then. So, yeah, well, if everyone's in the room, so Jason can get on, we'll jump to item 9. Is this something I can get in the front?
Yeah.
Yeah, it is. Okay. Jason, so this is the case ID for the local government's funding. Jason, have you gone?
Thank you, Chair. Thanks for allowing me to move up the agenda. So this item is in relation to an adult social care issue and related to a specific case. So this report is brought to this committee following the local government ombudsman finding that the council, the adult social care service, were at fault in this particular case and its decision to publish its own report, its own findings. Having accepted the local government ombudsman's recommendations in full, it's appropriate to bring the report consideration of this committee, and it will also be presented to Cabinet later in June. The complaint itself was initially made back in January 2017, so it has unfortunately taken quite a considerable time to get to this stage, and I'll come on to that a bit later. Members are asked to note the report, so no decisions to make other than to note the report. I think the report sets out the actions that have been taken to make sure that the injustices caused do not occur in the future, and I'll come into some of the detail on that. It is a confidential case, so the person won't be named. The person that it refers to is referred to as Mr. Y in the report. Mr. X is the complainant, and his son, and there's another son, Mr. Z. As I've said, the original complaint was made back in January 2017. The council investigated the complaint, formally responded in March 2018, which is obviously a length of time later. Mr. Y has since sadly passed away, and the local government ombudsman's findings have recently been published, so that's the timeline of this. The complaint itself, originally in 2017, is summarised on the top of page 119 in the packs, and that is that Mr. X complained that the council provided his late father, Mr. Y, with a home care service which was not adequate and charged him for a service that he did not receive. And that when he complained, he says the council failed to deal with his complaint properly or to take effective safeguarding action. So that's what the local government ombudsman looked into. It's important to say that each case that the Ombudsman looks into takes into account the individual circumstances of the case and responds on the findings in relation to that particular case. The Ombudsman doesn't have legal power to force councils to act in any way following its recommendations, but councils almost always do accept the local government ombudsman's findings and accept the recommendations. councils are often asked to do things as a result of the LGO finding. Things that we are asked to do sometimes include issuing an apology, paying a financial remedy, or improving our procedures so that the similar issues don't happen in the future. And as I say, we straight away accepted the ombudsman's findings in this case. Just in terms of some brief background to the case, just so we have a flavour of what it's about, the council has arranged a package of care and support for Mr. Y in his own home. He was responsible for paying the full cost of his care. He had a considerable size of care package. He had 4 calls a day, 2 carers for each visit. He needed a lot of support, and it's fair to say that he was very reliant on his carers. He was very dependent. So a very sad case, unfortunately not unusual in the level of support that older people often need. So he's very reliant on his care package, and it's with great regret that the care package wasn't adequate in this case. Safeguarding issues were raised early on that went unnoticed. They weren't properly investigated to conclusion, and we accepted that. The council's intention to focus on people's needs rather than on the timed tasks and amount of care provided in itself isn't an issue in this case, because it's right that councils and adult care departments focus on people's needs and outcomes in the round. However, when we investigated this case and when the LGO investigated this case, 59% of the calls to this person during this time scale had less than 75% of the time that had actually been commissioned to be provided, so consistently there was under provision against what had been commissioned to meet his needs. So either we were commissioning too much care, or the quality of the care wasn't meeting the outcomes required. So the council was found at fault in the way that it dealt with his complaints as well, because Mr. X's complaints took a long time to be dealt with. And there were parts of the process of looking into the complaint that could have identified some of the issues that could have been resolved earlier on. So we did recognise that. To get to a summary of the recommended actions that the council should have taken, we have accepted all of these. I'll go through them. They're on page 113, numbers 1 to 6 on the table. The first one was to apologise to Mr. X, detailing the faults that we accept. We have undertaken that. We've written to Mr. X on a couple of occasions and recently to offer a full apology. The second was that we waive 50% of Mr. Y's care fees, his charges, to remedy the financial loss that was caused. We have accepted and agreed to do that, and we're in the process of revising the invoice to send down for the care fees that are due. The third one is that we pay a small £200 remedy of frustration and stress that we caused to Mr. X in terms of him taking the time to make the complaint and communicate with the department over it. So we have action that we've made that payment. The fourth one is that we refer the issue to the safeguarding board, and this is the Merseyside Safeguarding Adults Board, with a request that they consider whether to hold some formal review process of the case in terms of the safeguarding, because we absolutely accept we didn't get it right on this occasion. Now, that action has been taken and it has been referred to a subcommittee of the local the Merseyside Safeguarding Adults Board, and a recommendation has been made to the independent chair of the board that is on the agenda for the meeting on the 26th of June. So we've left that with the chair of the board as to whether or not they want to discuss that in full of the board. The fifth recommendation is that we ensure that relevant complaints and assessment staff have received the appropriate training around safeguarding. And you'll see from the information on the agenda that we have actually undertaken safeguarding training across the board with the complaint staff as well as with operational teams. We held a 2-day training course for staff that was led by an independent safeguarding trainer from the university. The final one is that we review the complaint handling process, and that's partly due to opportunities that were missed during this process of identifying things that we could have done. So we have made some changes. We've appointed additional resource to that team, and clearly that we're performing better on handling complaints. So those are all the recommendations which we accepted and we've taken action on, so as to assure the committee that we've done so. Just a very quick update on some of the changes we've made in relation to domiciliary care services themselves, because this was very important in this case. We've moved to all of our contracted domiciliary care providers adopting a trusted assessor role. So that means that they can undertake assessments and risk assessments and reviews in relation to changing circumstances for the people that they support, without having to wait necessarily for a social worker to be allocated to come and do that. The outcome of those processes has to be validated by the social care teams before changes are made. And in that process, any significant changes to the care packages that affect people's financial contribution towards their care costs are flagged and discussed with them so that they're aware of any potential changes to that. So that's across all providers now. And I think in this case, this is where perhaps we could have acted earlier by reviewing the individual needs once the issues were raised to us. So that's in summary the findings of the local government ombudsman investigation and recommendations and the response that we've taken to. It is regretful in this case that we didn't get it right, and we have acknowledged that fully. So I'm happy to take any questions and answer as best as I can.
Yeah, just before you do a bit of a concern yourself, if that's okay. I mean, it's extremely disappointing, obviously, that this gentleman has had this case, and I'm sure it's caused him no end of, it did cause him no end of grief and heartache. Now, what I'm all concerned about is that I can see parallels here to going back to 2010, 2011. When we had an issue of overcharging vulnerable people back then. In my memory, serves me correct, and some people will be able to correct me in those years and I'm right when first emerged. So at that point in time, we learned the lessons and we went away and we took on board and what the reports had actually said. And ultimately, there's a parallel here that we've either not provided the right, correct level of care or we've overcharged. Now, with regards to the service provider, the trusted care provider, we're coughing up the refund, which we should have done. Have we then chased that up to get that refunded from the registered care provider? Because ultimately we're trusting them to provide what we're paying for, and they haven't done. So surely they actually owe us the money back on that level.
Okay, to respond to the first part of that, the findings were largely in relation to safeguarding processes not being identified and invoked early enough and not completed, and then the fact that we should have reviewed the case to make sure that the right level of care was being provided. I think it's a fair question as to whether we've gone back to the care provider to ask for some consideration of actually the fact that we are waiving part of our charges here, and to ask them to respond accordingly. I'm not sure if we have done that, so I will take that away, and I will definitely look into that, and it's a fair recommendation to make from the committee.
Thank you. The first thing I want to say is you said 59% of the visits, 75% those, explain that for me, the 75%. Basically, he was getting paid. The provider was getting paid for service that wasn't delivered because the assessment was the need was identified in terms of time rather than actually what the care was. Was that right? So we might say the gentleman needed four half-hour visits a day, and within that half-hour envelope they had to perform certain tasks. Is that what we're saying? And they did it quicker. The question I'm asking is, was there any suspicion that his care needs weren't met? That's the first thing. That he was in any way neglected? That's the first question.
Okay. So the first part of that, is yes, because the care provider wasn't providing the level of care that was required, there were some quality issues with the care that were identified. And this is in the report, there's some detail of the exact specifics of that. Some of it was relating to practice around using the hoist, moving handling techniques, amongst other areas. So there were genuine concerns that were raised here by the complainants about the quality of care that should have been investigated more thoroughly as safeguarding issues.
Well, the other question for me to ask you then is there any intention to bring this to the Adult Social Care Committee? I mean, we haven't had our first meeting yet, but when we do, I will be asking to be committed to this minded to set up health and care panel. And this is the kind of thing that we could explore in some detail, because it is very, very difficult. I do understand that when you're assessing somebody's needs, it's very, very difficult to quantify how you're going to pay for that if you don't put a time scale on how that care need is going to be met. I do understand that, but I do think there would be value in this report, actually. I mean, it's good that it's coming to standard, but it's more properly directed at the Adult Social Care Committee, where they can explore it in detail, I would suggest.
I'm glad you're here to ask that, because that's exactly what I was thinking as well, last year. I think that makes perfect sense as well.
Certainly consider that request, and I'll discuss that further and confirm back to the committee. Just in terms of the care, amount of care that was delivered, you were asking about clarification of what the report was saying around the percentages. So this was in relation to the time of care that was investigated, the period of care that was being investigated. So during that period that was investigated, 59% of the visits that were delivered, 75% of the care time was delivered. So there was a consistent under provision of the time of care, as well as the quality issues.
Okay, thank you.
Yes.
Chair, I mean, yeah, this is a really sad case, isn't it? And really, you know, I imagine there's a bit of loss of dignity as well around some of the practices or lack of use of the hoist, etc. And I can see that, you know, all complaints have been actually heavily impacted on this because of the nature of the complaint. So it could have been a complaint about something that was fairly minor that was overlooked, but unfortunately this, so there was a delay in this. It's good to see that systemic change came out of this. I can see that it was 50% that would be formed of the charges. The pathology might seem small to the lay person, but actually I work with the team really on this in my job, and pathology payments are there as a recognition of an error. They're not there to provide compensation per se. And actually £200 payment is quite large. In this case, I've seen the 20, I think it's £10. So it recognises the severity of this. It's disappointing in the current climate of sort of mounting concern around the social care crisis, which is fully aware of that, particularly the past few weeks on the BBC, and that's really heartbreaking to watch and very worrying. Lesson learned, it's been a really sad case, and I can't really say that I'm pleased that it's been sorted out finally, but I hope that there will be some real lessons learned from this.
Thank you for the report. I'd like to have some further information that probably come out within scrutiny that goes forward about whether this was an isolated case by this provider, whether there'd been any further in-depth look at the company and the provision of other people. I'd hate to think that it was systemic, that something was happening across the board, and I'd also like to know whether this company was still providing the care packages that we are putting out to people.
I'm sure Jason can train us sort of answers to those questions.
I'm aware that at the time of this, because let's remember it was quite a while ago, at the time of this particular care agency had taken on a significant amount of care, so there were pressures within the system at the time. Things have moved on, and we've
paragraph 411 in the report of the there's a reference to what the providers must do. It's that voluntary type, which is submit a monthly service quality performance report covering the performance management requirements. So I'm wondering who sees those and where they go to. Would they be rather than the standard reporting spreadsheets that we get to deal with the world plan, perhaps the other committee can have sight of those, or if not, the committee itself, the working party, so we can see exactly what providers are saying about the monitoring.
My dissatisfaction, sorry to say that, my dissatisfaction with the level of scrutiny, because I don't think this is ever the changes to the way that the trust is assessed. I think it's never been the committee, and I really, really think it should have been. Okay, that was just a sorry.
Okay, thank you, Councillor Gilchrist first. The performance and quality reports are more in depth than the reports that referring to, and they're submitted regularly by providers to our contracts monitoring team, who work alongside our quality improvement team. So jointly, they're looking at contractual compliance and also quality provision and keeping an eye on the Care Quality Commission framework for inspections and so on. So they are looked at regularly and in more depth, but I think it's fair that you won't have had sight of those. Perhaps the health and care panel.
We'll have, but it's a matter for the health and care, but I think we can get that.
But certainly we'd be happy to share that information. What we have to be mindful of is that sometimes that information is commercially sensitive.
And that's one of the reasons, I'm sorry to have a dialogue across the through the chair, that's one of the reasons why we have a health and care panel rather than a subcommittee.
Exactly, but there's no reason why we can't share that information with our board.
Paul.
Thanks, Chair. Just to pick up on what Councillor Wood said with regards to the actual companies, to whether they are continue to provide care. Could you also just check that if that company in its name isn't providing, that it's not a company that's been closed down as care company and reopened as care company, but if that company in any form is still providing the care, what checks and balances did you sort of put in place to ensure that going forward is not going to make the same mistakes and tracking all over again? I appreciate you putting those answers to those questions, but they are the questions that you need to come armed and help our board committee, our board's committee. Thank you.
Just briefly to respond to that, yes, I will make those checks. We shouldn't assume from this that there's a systemic problem with that provider, or have to say it is an individual specific case that has been looked into. The local government ombudsman is very clear on their role in investigating this. We completely accept we didn't get it right in this case, but we just need to be a little bit cautious about assuming there's a systemic problem with this provider, because there may well not have been.
One more, go on, Shelley.
With regard to care or anything else or anything that we deliver across the board, is that I would really like to say, and it goes back to the public, it goes back to being a resident, is that how much engagement or how much of the process do they feel that they're able to actually, rather than having to go to ombudsman or complaints in, how much of a flow of information is there so that they can feel that, say, if someone comes out to them, do they have a set of paperwork that they know is a photograph, the name, details of where they can go, what they can do, if there's any problem, so that they don't feel that they're isolated in their home receiving poor care, or even so maybe they're receiving good care and they want to put that back before they don't know if they've got any complaints. I would hate to think that anything that we do is sort of done to people rather than provided for.
It's always a challenge, this, because in the centre assessments when we first see people, carers' views, their absence is very important in getting their views included in the assessment process. The trusted assessor process that I referred to with the volunteers is built in that they include the family members and representatives within that process, and they need to ensure that they take those views on board so that everybody's in agreement. We are pushing our online self-assessment and self-review tools so that people can access the information and make their views, and then as well and request reviews if they think the circumstances have changed. The uptake is very low, and we know, but that's another avenue that we can use. And typically, although not all agencies keep paper files in people's homes, care providers often do, so that's often there for families to see, and that's still practice that happens.
Sorry,
you don't
have a
paper file.
That's good to hear that, but obviously with the demographic that we're talking about, that online system is always not the best. It's just to be mindful of that.
Thank you very much for that, Jason. I think we are to note that report here. Agreed? Thanks a lot. Okay, next item on the agenda is code of practice for governance of council interests in companies. So this is page 21 to 56 on the agenda, and the recommendation is that the code of practice was to be referred by the council for the standards and constitutional oversight committee. I'm sure everyone's had to take a look at this. It's a very in-depth report, lots of legal jargon in there. Would you like to speak to this one from?
Jargon galore. Thank you, Chair. This is code's final committee step on this journey. Last September, it went to the audit committee and also to the business and management overview and scrutiny committee before it went on for the leader decision. Leader decision suggested that it go to this committee to find its way then, perhaps as a recommendation to be formally adopted within the council's constitution. What you have is a code of practice, a blueprint, if you like, of how the council would engage with the commercial companies it owns. So it does very much fit into the previous conversation, which is about this is an organisation which is entrusted with public money that demands transparency and accountability and all the things that you've been talking about, and therefore is not always fit within how people might imagine a commercial company will operate, a common conversation of how council governance and company governance in the fast-moving commercial world that requires marketing strategies and high levels of commercial confidentiality and fast decision making fits within public trust and public monies and accountability in that way. So where councils now that they're allowed to own commercial companies and indeed trade through commercial companies, either as a wholly owned company or as a joint venture with a private sector partner, and go out and trade on the market, how the company it owns and the council, what the gearing is between the two. So a considerable amount of work has been done to produce what is here a national example. This is now a model that's used up and down the country that's been put out by professional bodies. I declare with interest because of the timeline, I was a party to its creation. But nonetheless, what you have is a model that's been checked through various law firms and been adopted up and down the country. What I need to say is the huge length, hand out the cocoa whilst not doing it. The only thing to highlight is there is one difference between what's here and what is in the National Model. What's in the National Model is a suggestion that council-owned companies are held through a set of a holding company. When discussed at the shareholder board with the leader, it was considered that that shouldn't be the way the will should operate for the holding company, but that each company should be looked at separately. So that's a change that was incorporated. That's the only change that's in here, the difference from the national.
Just excuse me, the fantastic AC system has decided to crash again.
So whilst that's crashing, just to say the structure of this follows the structure of the council's solicit for solace model code of corporate governance that the council adopts as its corporate code.
So, if there's any questions, yeah, Chris?
Thanks, Chair. Just a question, really. This came to us, I think, at a previous committee, not just in this format, but about bringing forward a code of governance. Yes, I feel that. One of the questions I asked Sarah was, what could we have a list of companies that the council was either had itself or was with a joint venture? And I've looked through the report, that list does not appear. And the government's arrangements are the same regardless of whether it's a joint venture, whether it's a wholly owned, or the difference in terms of how that is this code of conduct. Code of governance written to encompass all evils, shall we say, want of a better phrase. And I think one of the other questions we asked at the time, apart from the list of companies, was could we have or would availability be given to minutes of meetings of these companies, whether they be board meetings or other types of meetings, as the council has an interest in them. Would we have the availability to see what is being discussed?
On the list of companies, I understood that the list was going back to the audit committee. It ought to come back here, it should be as well as our board. I'm not sure that's distributed. We have straight off. Shareholdings in five companies at the moment of varying types. So, one of which, for example, Mersey Maritime is a company limited by guarantee, so it is in effect operates as a semi charitable body, there's no profit made from it. We have Wirral Evolutions, which is a wholly owned trading company, but what's called a technical company, so it's not subject to external procurement. Services right back to council in the circle, and so he's unlike others because we are both owner and client and contractor, so that needs to be triangulated in the process. We have a shared company in terms of essential that trades, but again, it's a company limited by government, it's a community interest company. So there's a guarantee that neither of the owners of the company will take a profit share out of it, so the profits are always fed directly back into the company to improve the services, lower the cost, and that provides services to schools. And then a sort of, which we know is the Wirral Growth Company, which is actually a limited liability partnership, so operates in a slightly different way, is being governed in a similar. And yes, what's here covers pretty much all the laws, but it's focused very much on the trading company, the ones out there where the council service have got to make money for the company, and we've just established a small housing company, which is person is nominated as the shareholder representative. Previously, that was the leader. It's going to be nominated elsewhere this time. I understand.
So, I'm in paranoia to me.
Part of what was it is that the board minutes of those meetings, the idea of having a shareholder board is that the way that the company is scrutinised is multi-level. So at its very highest level, the council has to approve the business plan for the forthcoming year of that company, and then that sets out the parameters by which the company can operate. So that's something that would ordinarily ought to be brought through scrutiny and possibly even cabinet depending on company chain. So for example, with the World Growth Company, there's a commitment there that the annual business plan and the transfers of land will be formal cabinet decisions. But of course there's also a lower level of information which is related to where the council is an investor or perhaps has loaned and set up. So there's a money flow with the company on a very much a cash basis. So there's a need for a much greater level of discussion and emphasis about trading and financing. That by its nature is highly sensitive. As you might imagine, in Central, for example,